Hi Nishikant.
Hi.
Hi, Nishikant.
Hi, yeah.
I think let's start.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, Nishikant. Can you just tell me about yourself, Nishikant?
Yeah, so myself, Nishikant, right now I'm working at the Bank of America at Malad. Overall, I have 8 years of experience in IT, out of which 4 years goes into the big data. So here I've been working for the past 4 years in the big data domain right now. The Bank of America at here, we support the US market. So we are the technical arm, so we let the traders book trade efficiently, right? That is our job on day-to-day basis, basically, here at the Bank of America.
Okay, that's
Yeah.
good. So, Nishikant, can you tell me how many projects you have worked on for the entire 4 years on big data?
There are two projects that I've worked on.
What is the timelines?
On the first project, so recently for the past 1 year, I've been working on the Azure database project, and for the past roughly 3 years, I've been working on the on-premise cluster.
Okay, so you told me
3 years
that
and one
you.
year.
Oh, so it is basically 3 plus 1. So from the past 1 year, you're working on Databricks platform.
Azure Data Lake, Databricks. Yeah.
Okay. So what is the project all about? Can you elaborate?
Yeah. Sure. So as I said, this is about share market, right? So usually we receive data from different upstreams, which is the account, the eligibility team, the scoring team, trades team, right? So we have defined this comprehensive 3-trillion architecture, which has the ingestion layer, processing layer, publishing layer, right? And this is where you apply the KPI analytics to, bring out churn, the data, bring about some decision making, which helps our management team and traders to book efficiently, right, in terms of finding the trade summary across the regions, finding the effective trades or dormant accounts or active accounts, what are the active or most used collateral, right? So the usual KPIs that help our traders and management to take better decision on a day-to-day basis, right? We also transform the data which can be used by the downstreams, basically, for their own KPIs,
Okay,
right? So as a
so
part of end-to-end, if I to say,
yeah, so you meant you have different upstream applications and the downstream applications.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, so the data, what you get, the data, in which format you get the data? Is it a live stream data or you get the data in the form of a batch?
It's a batch job, so we get data of the T minus 1 days.
So you define KPIs on the batch data, is it? On the batch data, you process it and then you define the KPIs.
That's right.
Okay, so what
That's
are the
right.
different
Yeah,
KPIs
yeah.
you compute?
So, as I said, we have different regions, EMEA, APAC, and Asia. So the KPIs would include finding the trade summary across all the regions, right? Trade summary could include the maximum, the revenue that is generated, or it could also be just a report as to how the trades went well. The other KPIs will include the demonstration or the graph, or I would say how a particular account is behaving per region. If the account is very aggressive, that could mean a lot of trades are being handled to that account. If the account is dormant, then they take another decision accordingly. Another would be for a particular trade, all is a trade has a security, a bond, a cash collateral, right? So that our job is also to recognize which is the most eligible security or collateral, so the traders can book the efficient trade accordingly and save money also, right? So these are some of the KPIs that I work on.
Okay, that's good. So, Nishikant, can you tell me what are the different programming languages you have used as part of your project?
Here, mainly I've used Scala. I deal with the Spark, so that where you use Scala, the SQL for HiveQL and SparkQL. And we also use a little bit of Python because we have some legacy applications here to support. So that is where we use Python.
Okay. Nishikant, can you tell me what made you to choose Scala as a language? Why not other languages, maybe
I
Java or
think,
Python?
so with Scala, I'm talking about distributed processing. That is where the Scala comes to the picture. It gives you a very good support. In Scala, the functions are first class citizens, right? So when I talk about function calling, I can pass functions rather than objects with respect to Java, right? And this is a very good plus point for distributed processing, where I don't have to talk about the objects but functions, right? So I don't have to talk about maintaining states of them, so concurrency and those issue won't come there. And Scala also has its inbuilt nature about pure functions or immutability, that gives you a plus point.
Nishikant, right. Yeah. You spoke about functions, right? Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Java also supports functional programming. I mean, you can pass a function to another method and a method can return a function with the concept of functional programming in Java. Still, Java also supports. But still, what did you, why did you choose Scala?
I think the other thing would be the lazy functionality that the Scala also provides, right? Immutability is also there. You know, everything with the Scala use if
was there any language decision taken as part of your management committee, or did you do any kind of a POC to evaluate like Scala as a little better than other programming language?
Unfortunately, when I went there, I mean, it was already, it was, the flow was already there, right? I kind of joined in between, right? So I would say the other decision was also with the skills also, because we had a lot of Scala developers in pool.
Okay.
Right. So that was the one decision that I remember. But otherwise, from my study and from my research, all I can say is it gives you good process, good support for pure function, right? Which is where the distributed processing comes into the picture, where input and output, it defines basically. So, more or less.
Okay, right. Nishikant, can you tell me about your production cluster size?
So on Databricks or on the...
in general, your production deployment, what would be the size of the cluster? Any of your deployments?
So you need to ask number of machines, nodes, basically?
Correct. Yes.
Okay,
yes.
Okay. So in production, we have roughly around 50 nodes, right? And then the size would be, each node has roughly around 20 cores, 24 cores, I think, yeah. And 512 gigs of memory, RAM, what we have.
Okay.
And so for the master node, we have more. Go ahead.
Yeah. You please go ahead.
Yeah, and for the master node, we have some more memory, RAM actually, and roughly around the same number of cores, and three name nodes for high availability.
Okay, Nishikant. So was the same configuration used even in your test environment to test the performance?
No, it was. We had roughly around 10. The nodes there, and the cores were same, but nodes were different. 10 nodes, yeah.
But how did you certify that the performance is guaranteed with the test bed being configuration different and in the production being the configuration different? How did you certify the product performance to the customers?
Well, for that, I think in QA, we had 10. Yeah, 10. I think we worked on this, the data, right? For in the QA, for example, in dev, we had a little lesser clusters, but in QA, as a 10 nodes that we had, I think more or less we replicate the same data, but we couldn't work on the same volume of what we had in production, but more or less we had to cut down the volumes, but that's how we performed.
But
we couldn't replicate the exact volume there in the lower environment.
Okay, so the data what you had in your test bed, was it a kind of a cooked up data, or was it like the data which has been copied from one of the customer, or kind of a data you had for testing purpose?
So whatever we get for production, right, the data is also we get it in the upstreams for our own activities. Sometimes we cook up if at all we need to probably have some variations of it for some testing, but otherwise it is always that we receive from the streams, basically upstreams.
Let's come to the Spark now. In Spark, where exactly the data used to store in your clusters, Anishikant?
It's on HDFS,
so it is on the Hadoop. So Hadoop, you meant you were using Spark with Hadoop?
Yarn. Spark on Yarn.
Right, Spark with Hadoop means Spark on Yarn. Okay, so what is the file size you used to deal with in your project?
Roughly, so on the trades data, it is 10 GB, roughly I would say.
You said average, you were dealing with batch processing, right? So you were processing at 10 GB of data?
Yeah, so on a daily basis, right, on T-1, I'm telling you roughly the entire volume of the collecting files. We're getting multiple files and roughly it would count to 10 GB. From T-1 from the upstream, and then we would put it in the low lake, the HDFS lake, and then we would apply the validations, verifications, and then transformation using Spark on the data. So collective size would be roughly around 10 to 12 gigs.
Okay. Now my question is, you were getting a file of single file of size 10 GB?
No. So collective size files of, multiple files basically.
So what is the file size you used to get from your, you were telling you were getting data from your downstream applications, right?
Upstreams.
Upstreams.
So
what is the file size actually?
It would vary. Sometimes it would get roughly around 5 GB, two or 5 GBs, or, you know, one of 2 GB and then multiples. I wouldn't say it was roughly 10 GB every time, because that is how the upstreams would work. I mean, they had their own logics, and, you know, as per their legacy system, they would generate the files and then we would get it. So not really 10 GB at a time, but the size could vary.
How long does it used to take for a job to run actually, to process this the single file of 5 GB of data? So for any KPI to compute, so roughly around how much time for a script to run?
So I'll tell you about 10 to 12 gigs of data. It used to run about 2 hours. I mean, the pipeline that was tell you about the verification, validation, and then, you know, the transformation that I prepared with Spark, loading data on the Parquet again, saving roughly around 2 hours.
So it was taking two hours to compute like somewhere around 15 gigabytes of data. And was there 12, any optimization? Was there any optimization done to improve the performance? Maybe you or maybe as part of your product to improve the performance. Like, was there any optimization done?
I mean, with respect to Spark, definitely, you know, we had some issues initially, because I'll probably share one concern that we had during the US holiday, right? So we get data from different regions, right? During the US holiday, and we did not anticipate it, there were no rates. So there were very less rates. But at the same time, we had rates from other regions. So if you look at the data now, the data is not distributed properly. You have roughly around very less rates from US, but very high volume from other, you know, probably the other trades, and vice versa, right? In terms of US election, right? We notice a very high volume of US trades. So while during the join, we noticed that there was a skew of data happening, and few, you know, mappers or few the executives were running for a longer period of time. And that is where, you know, we did not know about it, that data would be so high. Unless we until we got this marker from the upstream saying, you know, there's some notification happening. So there we had to apply some salting there to proper distributed data, and then, you know, bring about the joins, and then, you know, the optimization. So then that was the scenario where we really stuck, because all of a sudden we saw our jobs, you know, running very, you know, a long period of time, and no failure was there, and data seems to be also fine. But then when we actually looked into the data and with the notifications, the other things were, definitely about the joins, where we did optimization about the broadcast joins. The way the Spark provides, right, turning joins into broadcast joins, or using the Parquet files with the predicate pushdown, partition pruning, you know, we have the caching, all those capabilities that we use on a day-to-day basis to optimize the join. So we also looked at the performance of the Spark looking at the Spark UI to see how the joins are performing. What kind of joins are there, right? Can I probably convert a shuffle join to a broadcast join, you know, by doing more filter, you know? And then cost-based optimization is there, you know, and then with the data frame, definitely we have the tungsten and catalyst optimizer. So instead of RDD, we went to data frame to, you know, capture, you know, to basically have more performance gains there also. Yeah, so, you know, at every point of time, with, you know, we used to go to the Spark documentation and we see what new is there and do the POC and see if it works, and then probably, you know, include it in our code and then push it to the production. It's something which is ready to process that goes on and on.
Okay, but how did you handle this data skewness actually?
So we had to again, you know, repartition the data, the entire data. We had to introduce again a new column, you know, uniqueness basically, right, for the joining. That's what we did, introduce a new column, uniqueness, and then we did it basically.
Okay, just because you mentioned about you did repartitioning, can you just tell me what is the difference between repartitioning, partitioning, and sorry, repartitioning and Colask actually in
Yeah, so
Spark?
repartitioning is where it'll partition, it'll shuffle data across all the, it's a full shuffle basically, right? Where Colask is where it'll try to, so basically in general, repartition is where we try to increase the partition, right? And Colask is ideally where we try to reduce the partition. So Colask will end up less shuffle data, but it'll also end up giving the data may not be scattered well, but a repartition will make sure the data is scattered well, but it will be full shuffle, basically.
Okay, so if you're dealing with huge volume of data and you're saying that to reduce the data skewness, you did repartitioning,
No, I
and
mean not
eventually
really partitioning.
repartitioning
Sorry,
will.
my bad there.
Okay, one such tick, no problem.
Sorry.
Yeah, go ahead.
That is where we. So I would rather say we introduce a new column for joining, but not repartitioning. It was not there. My mistake.
Okay. So yeah, when coming to this join, you told that you were doing broadcast join. So the, when you were doing a broadcast join, like you were doing two different table join, like was there any scenario that one of the table was big and one of the table was small, or both the table was equally same
There
in
was a scenario
particular
where
to
one of the
broadcast
tables
join?
was
What
joined.
was the scenario?
So we had the account tables and the asset tables that were comparatively very small. So that is where we
Okay.
thought this is a good, the candidate of our broadcast in a join, because the account table, they don't grow. I mean, you have fixed accounts or fixed assets, they're less likely to grow as compared to trades, which is something which will grow, which can grow exponentially, in fact. So that was the main scenario
Okay.
for candidate for
Right. Nishikant, just a scenario I'm just asking you. Did you even, at least did you try to think of a scenario where, to reduce rather than doing a join, did you think of a scenario where you can denormalize your data and then you could have achieved it? I'm just putting the question to you. Did you try any evaluating this approach of rather than, normalizing the data and putting it to two different tables and performing a join? Did you think of denormalizing it and then did you try it out with that approach? Or was did you
So,
have
if
any
I'm
kind of a
just trying to
POC done in
understand,
it?
just trying to understand here. So, assuming I have two tables, account and trade table, where trade is something which is big, account comparatively small. You're trying to say is if I denormalize it further, make more tables
Yes,
basically.
yes. I mean, rather than rather than having multiple tables, why not you denormalize your data and put it into one single table so that you can avoid joins? Was did you think about that approach anytime
Well,
so
not
that you will
really.
reduce join?
No, not really.
Okay.
I would say, I
So
mean,
do you think, Nishikant, will it help actually? I'm just
Yeah,
giving a
that's what I'm
thought
trying to say.
process.
So, assuming I have one denominator stable, no, I guess. I mean, so just one table which will have, probably I'm just assuming one table which has trade data, asset data, eligibility, everything, one table. And then it'll grow exponentially, right? I mean, a table which also has to store, and plus this data, I mean, I'm assuming it's something where I'm talking about the storage for using for analytical purpose. And I think it may not help, because if I'm denormalizing it, I'll add more column and more rows, and the access would be sequentially. So I think, yeah, the separate tables, it's good for analyticals.
Okay, fine. Right. Nishikant, can you tell me something about, for example, let's assume you have a 200 MB of file, and when you push it into the Hadoop cluster, what would be the block size actually
200
for the
MB,
Hadoop cluster? The
assuming
file is
the
of
block size is
single file
128
is 200
MB.
MB. Okay. And when I create
And 128 MB is
RDD out of this file, how many partitions would be created, Nishikant?
So assuming the block size is 128 MB, the split size basically, can I assume that?
Yes, it's by default
So
input split
200,
size.
yeah, so 200 minus 128. So one is for 128, And then the other one be for the remaining, remaining part of it will be other one. Yeah. So
okay, so you say that when I create an RDD out of the 200 MB file, it will create two partitions.
Two partitions, yeah. Yeah.
Can I get the number of partitions actually? Is it possible to see how many number of partitions we
partitions.
Have? Get num partitions.
Yeah. RDD dot get num partitions. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Right. Now, coming to these RDDs, can you just tell something about these RDDs? What are these RDDs actually?
Yeah. So RDDs are resilient distributed data sets, basically, right? This is the lowest abstraction in Spark, basically, right? That we deal with usually. And as the name says, right, the resilience and it's distributed in nature and it's a data set. Mm-hmm. And it also has a lineage to it, right? So mm-hmm. we always compute with respect to lineage, and it is lazy in nature, right? It has a transformations, mm-hmm. Narrow wide transformation and actions,
mm-hmm.
and it builds up a lineage, right? So even if I lose, it will always go back to the previous lineage and it can compute again. Mm-hmm. So that is where the fault tolerance comes to the picture also. You never lose anything, can always go back.
Okay, now and, coming to this lineage mentioned, let's assume you have a 200 MB file, you perform some transformation. Mm-hmm. For example, you have a records of, let's say, 200 records, and you're applying some transformation. For example, you're trying to convert, you're trying to multiply some experience with some digit. And for the entire 200 records, when you apply a transformation, you'll have another 200 records. So right. Do you think in the memory, you'll have 200 records plus 200 records after each transformation?
No.
You understood my question, right?
It's just transformation.
Correct.
Yeah.
No. Let's assume I perform an action.
Okay. So let's say I call a map and again map, basically.
Correct. You right? create an RDD.
Eventually you won't have 200 records. Just one record, like same records, getting to next transformation, next, unless with action. And then it'll, go from one to the another. In chain, basically.
No. Let me repeat my question.
Called, but you won't have 200 plus 200.
Let me repeat my question again. Let's assume you have 200 records. Let's assume the total 200 records is of size 200 MB. You created an RDD.
Okay.
And then you applied map transformation. Map That's transformation right. also leads to the same 200 records only.
That's right.
And then finally, you try to print the RDD.
That's right.
Okay. Now, so when you loaded an RDD, it loaded 200 MB of data. You applied a transformation. I'm asking you a question now. Will it have another 200 MB of data in memory when you apply a map transformation? Let's assume I apply two map transformations.
No.
So what would be the total size in the memory?
No, it wouldn't be. It will be the same, right? Because map. When you say map create. New records as the name says, it'll map it to the operation, right? If it's let's say map x comma one, right? X comma one is my record, right? To the previous transformations, right? So now we have a new transformation, new lineage, basically, right? That's how it moves, basically. The next, if you call map again, the same, the record will move to the next transformation, right? And eventually, when it hits the action, those 100 records will be processed, so you'll always have the same records, yeah.
So you
unless you call flat maps, which will have records.
That is fine. So you meant at any time you load, you create an RDD, 200 MB of data. Once you apply series of transformation, still it will be only 200 MB.
Yeah, unless you again filter.
Final. I will apply the action. I'll only apply map transformations, and finally I will perform some action.
Yeah. You have 200.
Okay. So have you used RDD anytime?
For unstructured data, for a couple of uses, definitely we have used.
So you have used RDDs for processing unstructured data.
Unstructured data.
We can't really process unstructured data in data frames, is it?
I think RDD provides you a good, capabilities as per my experience, right? We can simply create new. So as per that's what we did, we created new. Case classes and the text, we had some text files with some junk characters, and with the RDD we could simply separate and split those files, and I already also give you compliant support. So with this schema, if I have the trait schema, I can just map to trait schema, and I'll right away I have compliant support. That way we could do that really with unstructured data. Yeah.
Okay. So why can we also we can also process structured data using RDDs, right? What made you to choose? I think you have you I see from your resume that you have used data frames.
Yeah, yeah.
So
yeah.
what made you to choose data frames when you already have an RDD?
I think data frame is particularly useful for because we are also dealing with the SQL kind of you know the capabilities, right, for querying the data. That is where data frame also comes into the picture. Gives a DSL language, right, where you can query the data with SQL, you know, capabilities also, and also so it's a structured schema, you know, platform where you know it's something as good as SQL table basically. So it becomes easier to operate on that. And also, it internally it is very optimized. It uses tungsten row format and Kotlin optimizes, right? So, on and all, with respect to RDD, it gives you good, you know, performance benefit, plus a good support for SQL and DSL languages. Yeah. So development becomes easier. Yeah.
Okay. You mentioned that this data frames uses Catalyst Optimizer, right? Can you just elaborate about this Catalyst Optimizer? What exactly it does actually, at least at the high level?
Yeah. So basically. Yeah, so basically when you run any Spark query, right, internally, it optimizes the query plan, basically. So initially, it has unresolved query plan, right, where if you use the alias in a query, it doesn't know. It doesn't resolve to anything yet because it is unresolved. On top of it, it applies, you know, for the unresolved query plan, and it converts into a logical plan. And then you have optimized logical plan where it does the constant folding and expression evaluation. And now out of that, it creates a physical evaluation plan. And then after that, based on the cost optimization model, it tries to arrange the join to produce a better optimized, you know, plan with respect to cost. And then it you know, eventually executes it. So this whole cycle is you know, something which is there for data frame, you know. So that becomes...
Did you anytime analyze this the plans whatever is generated for a data frame after
so
performing
usually
a series of transformation?
Yeah, at the Spark UI we would look at it, you know, when we run the join, see if what we're expecting is it same behavior is happening and the log also, right? So that what we come to know if any partition bundling is happening or is the broadcast happening, you know. So yeah, definitely we would go there and check.
Okay. Rishikesh, let me ask you one scenario. Think about a scenario that a particular job is running and you had introduced some bug. You know that there was a bug in the code and accidentally it got released and it is in the production. Or you realize that, you know, the code has some bug and the job is already running.
Right.
So what would you do now? So, you got my question clear, right?
Let's so just assume to rephrase it,
you have a job which is running. And the job is like it is taking longer time than expected. And then immediately, let's assume you verified the code and you got to know what is the issue. So what would you do for a job which is running in the production?
Okay, so just to rephrase, job is running production, it's taking some time.
It's taking longer time, which is
lot of
beyond
time.
Our anticipation. Right.
It's two, basically.
Yes.
Yeah. And now I've rectified the issue. It's in dev right now. The code is fixed right now. Okay. But production is still running. I need to fix it, basically, right? What would be my action?
Correct. Okay. First, the job is running because the entire product to ship, it has to go entire DevOps lifecycle and then only we can ship the code.
Yeah,
but
yeah,
till
yeah.
then, the job is running. And it is eating
still
up your
production.
Entire
yeah,
resources.
True. Yeah, yeah. I think it would be to kill the job first. I mean, it not would be me immediately because we don't have to do that. We convey it to my the system teams to kill the job first and foremost, right? And then
this is a question
you know,
now, Nishikant. Right. Now, let's assume you said your production team is there. You will inform them. Till then, they would have raised a mail for you and then for you to take an action, it would take longer time. Correct? For the entire thing to come to the development, it would take definitely a longer time. Till then, the job is running.
Yeah.
So what would be your steps, actually?
I think immediate, right? As you said, immediately. So in our case, right, usually, whenever such thing happens, production team usually, you know, they kill the job right away because it is always anyways taking resources and it crosses the threshold, right?
How do so you kill the job?
They have the threshold.
Okay, let's
so usually from
threshold
the Spark
is reached.
UI, Spark UI, there is an option to kill the job, right? So you can kill the job there itself. And then, you know, we would be getting all the logs about it.
So through Spark UI, you can kill a job, is it?
Yeah.
Okay. So are you sure with this?
Yeah.
Okay. So you, so the person has to go to the Spark UI and you say Spark UI provides you to kill a job.
Yeah. And also, I mean, they also have the scripts to the kill, right? Using Yarn application also.
Uh-huh.
You can kill the jobs. Yeah.
So
yeah.
Can you tell me what is the command used to kill a job?
In Yarn?
Yeah, in Yarn.
I think it's Yarn.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I think it's Yarn. I may not be in the sequence, but you need to provide Yarn, kill command and the application ID to that.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
So fine. That is fine. So you meant that there are certain Yarn commands to basically kill an applications.
Kill an application. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So just because you mentioned that, you know, you are using Spark with Hadoop, was there any optimization done at the Yarn layer to improve the performance? Because you spoke about Yarn improving the performance from Spark, from the Spark layer. But was there any performance parameters which can be improved at the Yarn layer to improve the performance? Did you have anything such scenario in your production?
Yarn level. So Yarn layer is basically talking about resource manager and node manager.
When I'm talking about Yarn, it includes the resource manager.
Not really that I can think of.
Okay.
No, not really that I can think of.
Okay, no problem. So how did you how you used to submit your Spark applications?
Yeah. Spark submit command is what we used to run to submit the applications. Yeah.
So you were executing the Spark submit command.
Huh.
And what is the option you used to use to submit it to Yarn?
Huh. Options as in we would use Spark shell usually to submit it to Yarn. Yeah.
No, you have used Spark shell to submit it to Yarn, is it?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, this in dev, that's what we do.
In production, no, I'm talking about in production,
we have Edge nodes. Via Edge nodes, our DevOps team would, you know, with Jenkins, they would put it there. And from there, they would execute. But we had to schedule, to be precise, we had our own inbuilt Bob monitor. Mm-hmm. It was a Python-driven Bob monitor that we used to, you know, schedule, and it will run internally in sequence. It also has the dependency capabilities, so we would always schedule. We could schedule the jobs one after the other with time zone dependencies, you know, and then the notification. So it was an inbuilt tool that we usually used. Okay
Nishikant. Nishikant, can you tell me what is the difference between Spark context and Spark session?
Well, there's only one Spark context, and Spark session is something which is built around the Spark context to get you more capabilities to the Hive context and SQL context. Uh-huh. So at any particular time, you can have multiple Spark session. You can also stop them, but only one Spark context will be available on your, you know, driver basically. Yeah. So one Spark context, you can have multiple Spark session. Yeah.
Okay. Right, Nishikant. Okay, Nishikant, I think, well done. We will... we'll just check we've taken your answers, and then I think we will just evaluate everything and I think then it'll be easy for us to, you know, jot it down, and then we will have further rounds of interviews.
Yeah.
Okay. Right, Nishikant.